I'm back here with Jumper's EZBook 3 Pro. This is the version 4 model. A very decent Apollo Lake laptop, one of the best ones that you can get, especially for the price it's been selling for, which has been $219. So I do get a lot of questions with this model when new owners get it. They want to know, okay, how can I clone over the eMMC to an SSD? So I'll go through that. I'll also go through the SSD installation, how we can also install a larger one. A few little tweaks as well, just to get the most out of this particular model and disabling those power limits. And also a copper heatsink mod, or add a thermal pad and a bit more copper there. And we'll see if we can lower those maximum temperatures down when you disable that power limit, which of course increases the temperatures. So we'll get started now. At the moment you can see I've got a completely fresh new version 4.1 here that has the default install here, the Windows 10 image. So we want to clone this over. And you can see it does come with some software called Touchpad Blocker, but honestly I recommend just removing this one because it doesn't really do too much, and sometimes it can make the precision touchpad we have on this feel a little bit unresponsive at times, because what it does is it accidentally blocks touches. So first off, you can uninstall and get rid of that. So if the device manager of your EZBook 3 Pro lists this a generic N card, that means you have one of the slower speed ones when it comes to the eMMC drive. Now a lot of people are quite lucky and they're getting Samsungs, they're also getting the SanDisks, which are eMMC 5 spec ones, which will perform quite quick. But I highly recommend installing an SSD, so you can get reads of up to 550 megabytes per second, and then writes up to about 500 as well, depending on what kind of drive you use. Now Jumper wants us to use a 22x42mm one, which I have installed here. So you just need one screw on the top, one screw here, slot in the SSD. So now for those who want to install larger SSDs, larger than the size they give us with that little flap. So that flap only accommodates for the 2242 size. Now to get into the back here, just remove all the screws around the outside. You also have to remove that screw that's holding down the SSD, the hatch on the back of it. So once you remove that, it's very easy to get this back off. And you can see the heatsink there is actually quite a decent heatsink. You don't need to do any thermal mods or anything to this under their standard 6-watt or 9-watt power limit that they have there in the BIOS. So it is very simple to actually install a larger SSD like my Crucial I have right here. Now the larger SSDs are normally cheaper and they also perform with faster writes normally. So the easiest way to do it is to simply lift up this little plastic a bit and with a knife or some scissors or something sharp cutting tool, just cut here and here. And that will allow you to then slot in a larger drive and use some electrical tape, so some insulated tape there, to hold the SSD in place. Otherwise you never know that if you were to drop the laptop, it could come loose and you could have some problems with that in there. You have to remove this screw. Now some users on my forum have gone as far as actually using a Dremel tool to cut down the thread where that screw is, so it lies completely flat. But I just put some tape over it on my other model, my version 3 that I had, and just did that, so that's easy. Now the second method is you could actually just unscrew the screws here and then remove this whole plastic around there without having to cut or damage that if you later wanted to return it to its original state. Now this part I get asked a lot, how can you clone the eMMC over to the SSD you've just installed? There's various different programs that can do this, but I'm going to use Macrium Reflect 7, and it's free, the home edition. So you just install this. Now in the application, you need to select this right here, which says clone this disk. So find the eMMC, this is where your Windows is installed, and here is my SSD. So select that, and you've got the SSD there, then click next, and we'll schedule it to clone over. So once all that's done, you will then have that version of Windows, exact copy of it, on your SSD. Now this will take a while, so you just have to be patient with it. Now if you're one of those users that has posted on my forum that, hey, my SSD's not showing up, I can't actually see it, then go along here and make sure it's formatted, especially if it's a new drive, you might have to do this. So double tap on the start menu or right click with your mouse, then go to disk management, and in here you want to find the SSD, which is right here. Now I've already got this here, but if it's not showing up, you'll have to format it first and I think you need to actually convert it to a certain type of disk that it'll ask you to do that, and then it should show on Windows, then you can clone it over. So hitting escape on boot will take us into the BIOS, and if you are lucky and you have one of the models that has the power limits unlocked, if you go here into advanced and then go along to CPU configuration, under power management, CPU power management here, you'll see right here we had the power limit 1 enabled. So you want to change that. If you want maximum performance, do this. But it will, of course, increase thermals and lower the battery life. Change that to disabled. And another tweak we can do, if you're lucky enough to get a Samsung or the SanDisk SSD, sorry, the eMMC drive, then we can go along into the self-cluster configuration and find SCC configuration. And you want to go to this one here. So on my eMMC, I can't change the setting. But if you are one of those lucky ones, put this onto high speed 400. If you get a blue screen, then try high speed 200. And that will definitely boost up those speeds of that eMMC drive to get it perform a lot better. Now finally, if you have installed that SSD, you're going to go with an SSD. Make sure you change the boot manager here to boot manager, and then the serial number or the model of your SSD drive, which is my one right here, the Transcend. So it's going to boot to that first. So the copper heatsink mod, if you do plan on running power limits off, you don't really have to do anything unless you plan to game on it for extended periods. That's when it will reach like 90 degrees. So what we want to do here is the easy method, cheap and easy method, is to place a thermal pad over this area. That will then have contact with the rear lid, transferring heat to this alloy lid, and heating up the bottom of the laptop quite a bit there. All the other method is what I'm going to do now is remove all these screws. So I've now taken off the heatsink, and we can see the RAM chips. So we've got 2 3-gigabyte chips there, made by Samsung. And here is the EMMC, which is a 4C brand on my model. But as I said before, this can vary. You can get SanDisk or Samsung and even Toshiba ones. Now, before we go any further, it's wise to remove the battery, the plug at least, so we've got no power going through the circuit board. Just in case we touch anything around here, make sure you earth yourself as well. So using some cleaning solution, you can clean the CPU die up. It doesn't really need too much because it's just had a thermal pad on there. Now I'm going to go with what I always go with. That's a 15mm by 15mm, 1mm thick copper shim. I'm going to place this on the top here. Now you'll notice that the size of this, maybe even 10 by 10 might be a little bit better because of the die. There's those resistors around the outside. Now I've done this mod now to a lot of models, and after 2 years of use on one of them, I haven't had any issues. So I don't think it's going to short out. As long as it doesn't get too close to any of those components there, the shim of course, you'll be fine. So I'm going to put a little bit of thermal paste on here. Now there are studies and people have done some tests here that more is actually better than not enough. So a little bit of about that amount is going to be okay. And then put the copper shim on the top of that. Now you want to center this really well so it doesn't get too close to any of those resistors there. Press down quite hard with a bit of pressure on that. Now you notice that those resistors, those two at the bottom, it's reasonably close, but I've had a look at this side on and there's still about a millimeter gap or so. So it's not going to touch it, make any contact and short anything out. Now I'll clean the factory heatsink. So I've just used a bit of alcohol in this part here. So here you can see how close the copper shim is to those resistors there on the side. It's very close, but I mean, if you're not happy with this, use a smaller sized shim. Or don't even do this mod. And now put a little bit of thermal paste, actually quite a bit on the top, it doesn't really matter. About that much will do. Now I'm using Arctic's MX4, but any normal kind of brand thermal paste will be perfectly fine. So carefully place now the factory copper heatsink on the top. Now because of the increased thickness, it might be a little bit hard to get this down, but that's what we actually want, is that pressure there. So that's going to hold both the thermal paste is going to hold and the pressure, that copper shim in place, and more pressure is also going to aid in the transfer of that heat away from the chipset. Now on the top, I have used a 17 by 17 millimeter, 1 millimeter thick thermal pad here. Any thicker than this, you'll have trouble getting the lid on, so I recommend only 1 millimeter. And then don't forget, of course, to then plug in the power. Now the BIOS may have reset, so when you power it on, you'll have to go back in, hit escape, and then change the settings back. So let's have a look at temperatures now. I've been playing Counter-Strike for 25 minutes, and I did the same test without the thermal mod, and I got up to 84 degrees. And you can see here now that this is really, really good. Look at this, 57 degrees on core zero, and the maximum I got up to is 59 degrees. So that is a massive, huge difference. So it just goes to show you that doing this mod is actually really worth it on lowering those temperatures. And I can see that the CPU power, it has gone up to almost 15 watts. So that is way over the stock limit. So you can see there that the power limit is off. So I do have another couple of tips here. Now, one of them is to go into the Intel control panel for the graphics, go to display, then color settings, where I am now, select color blue, and just turn that down about 5 points. Now, this is to your own personal preference, of course, tweak this, but I do find that the default calibration of this display is definitely leaning towards the cool white, and just minus 5, I've noticed, is a little bit better there, more neutral white and not so cool. Now, another couple of things we can do too is to update the Intel drivers. This is pretty much common sense. Most people know this, but a lot of people don't even bother. But jump on the Intel website, go and use their driver support assistant, get it to scan for your drivers, and then it'll update your Bluetooth, wireless, and graphics. So make sure you have the latest there. We'll just keep things running nice and smooth. Now, the things, of course, that again, common sense, trim the SSD drive, another thing that can help boost performance, is to do what I've done here, is don't have it being indexed at all. So allow files on this drive to have the context indexed. Apparently disabling this can help speed up the 4Ks, your random reads and writes on the drive. And one other thing as well too, that the speakers aren't very loud. There are some software applications out there like DW Audio, I think it's called, that can boost the performance. You're able to tweak up the gain on those speakers and increase the volume of them. So when you clone the eMMC over to your SSD, chances are your SSD will always be bigger because you probably go for 128GB or 256GB one. You will get this right here, which is unallocated space. So you need to go back into disk management in Windows, and then if you click on the C drive here, you can extend the volume so you regain that space there. The unallocated space will then be dedicated to that drive there, and then it's all usable, or you can partition it into another partition. So that just leaves us now with the eMMC. So it's up to you what you want to do with that. Of course, you could just leave it, or you can go along and just format that and create that as a second drive where you can store some of your files on. So best of luck there with your own thermal mods if you do decide to go that path and do that and disable the power limits. But just bear in mind though, you don't have to touch the heatsink if you don't want. You can just put a thermal pad on the top. That will probably lower temperatures, not 15 degrees, but maybe about 7 or 8 or something like that. So it is worth it. And if you're going to move over to an SSD, it is also worth it as well, especially if you have a 4C brand eMMC drive like I have. These ones are slower, and when you use the SSD, it does feel so much quicker. Boot times, shutdown times, and things like that. Overall system performance has improved quite a lot. So this is a great laptop for the price. And with these little tweaks here, we can squeeze even more out of it, which is good that we have this option here. Now, if you don't have the power limit there, then there's a software way of doing this as well. That just means running an application which will set a power limit of, say, 10 watts. Or you can set even unlimited as well there. So don't worry if your EZBook 3 Pro does not have that setting and you want it, you do at least have a workaround here. So thank you so much for watching this video, and I do hope to see you back in the channel soon. Bye for now.